this feeling in my bones. So good, I never felt this strong. And I can't hold it in no more. The truth will set me free, I'm sure. You got me feeling so good, and you know that I would. You got me feeling so good, and you know that I. You got me feeling so good, and you know that I would. You got me feeling so good.
The biggest weekend of the year is about to go off. As the superstars of NXT stand and deliver. It's a Philly thing. NXT Stand and Deliver, live from Philadelphia, Saturday, April 6th. Streaming exclusively on Peacock.
That we are having Tiffany Stratton on the show,
but
I didn't see her video on social media, and it kind of it struck a nerve. That was hurtful.
She called us clowns. I understand. Mm-hmm. I actually think like we're pretty professional. Like, could just any old clown draw on this board? I don't think so. I think it takes a pretty big professional. Sam, this is you here. You're gonna see a likeness with the hair.
Yeah, that looks like me. That looks like me. How about this for professional?
Oh, I'm the last professional broadcaster. Anytime there's an emergency, I got the siren ready to go.
Let it go.
Always ready.
Nobody knows the WWE superstars better than us. I mean, right. I've been singing "Whoop That Chick," Excuse me. And you guys wondered why I called you clowns. See, this is why I'm here, to bring the center of the universe to all of you. And today, the bump runs on Tiffy time.
This emergency.
We'll see you.
This maybe doesn't look great in retrospect. I promise it's not a clown show. I promise. You want? Should I draw you? Like I.
No, don't do that, please.
Start over.
Well, hello everybody, and welcome on into WWE's The Bump. That was an interesting interaction to start the day off.
A little out of context.
Yeah.
A little out of context.
Of course, but to give you some context, we are 31 days away from WrestleMania.
Oh, boy.
It truly is the best time of the year. Sam, how are you feeling?
The greatest time of the year. I am feeling utter joy. There is so much going on right now, not just in terms of what's going on at the tippity top of WrestleMania, but so many superstars fighting for their opportunity to get on the card of the biggest WrestleMania of all time.
Well, we got to bring in the third member of our team, Ryan Popolo, who's out there being a professional and monitoring social media. Ryan, what's going on?
I have cleared the board of what I thought were pretty excellent drawings, if I do say so myself, but neither here nor there. We're here to talk about the bump. We're here to talk about the road to WrestleMania, and we want you to be part of the conversation. How do you do that? Great question. I got an answer. Hashtag WWE The Bump on Facebook, X, Instagram, YouTube chat. I see Andrea Price. I see Nathaniel. I see Tara. Everyone's talking about Tiffy time. If you have comments, if you have questions, if you want to be part of this hour here today, get into that YouTube chat. Use hashtag WWE The Bump. Be part of the conversation. Megan.
Thank you so much, Ryan. Let's find out who's coming on the show today. Well, you guys already saw her. She's here. She is in studio for the first time ever. The bump is on Tiffy time.
Tiffy time works, too.
It does, because Tiffany Stratton is here today. We also have one of our favorite guests coming on the show. He is preparing for a gauntlet match, and he is looking for a way to punch his ticket to WrestleMania. Sami Zayn joins us later on in the show. And before we can get to all of that, we do have some news coming out of WWE this week. We want to wish congratulations to our guy, Paul Heyman, who is going in to the WWE Hall of Fame.
We are all Paul Heyman guys. There is nobody who deserves to be in the WWE Hall of Fame more than Paul Heyman, especially in Philadelphia, of all places, from managing the Dangerous Alliance to reshaping what America knew professional wrestling could be with ECW, coming in to WWE, telling stories on commentary, being a part of SmackDown on the creative end of things when it was revolutionizing everything, being an advocate, being a manager, being a representative.
A special counsel.
A wise man, Paul Heyman, one of the most influential people in professional wrestling.
And we also got breaking news this morning. So pull out the siren.
I told you. We need
some confetti. Bull Nakano in the class of 2024.
I can't believe
WWE Hall of Fame.
They're doing the Hall of Fame this year, I think, just for me. Bull Nakano, legitimately one of my favorite superstars of all time. Somebody who, you want to talk about revolutionaries.
Yep.
Changed the game for women's wrestling in the States in the mid-90s in WWE with her rivalry with Alundra Blaze, but everything she did in Japan, this may be the most ahead of her time superstar that's ever existed in the industry. So to see Bull Nakano being inducted into the WWE Hall of Fame, we did it.
I think, are you gonna induct her? Are you gonna induct Paul?
Well, I would like to put my name in the hat for both of them, if either of them would like to have Sam Roberts induct them, I'd be more than happy to make myself available.
Let's get that going. Hashtag we want Sam.
I don't know if we need. Let's just celebrate Bull Nakano and Paul Heyman, two of the goats of all goats.
Well, this siren has been getting some good mileage out of it. As we mentioned, we're on the road to WrestleMania. We want to talk about everything that's going on in WWE right now. And the universe shook on Friday when The Rock dropped a 22-minute video on social media ahead of Friday Night SmackDown. Now, on SmackDown, we were waiting for The Rock to address Cody Rhodes' challenge that he issued out at Elimination Chamber, and The Rock would counter with a challenge of his own.
Here's the challenge on night one of WrestleMania. The biggest tag team match in the history of the WWE. The biggest tag team match in the history of professional wrestling. It's gonna be Cody, Seth, against a Universal Champion and the People's Champion, The Rock. If you two jabronis beat The Rock and Roman Reigns on night one, then on night two at WrestleMania, your championship match, Cody Rhodes, will be free of the bloodline. But when The Rock and Roman Reigns beat your two candy asses on night one, then on night two, for your championship match, Cody Rhodes, it's bloodline rules. Anything goes. So how tough do you think you are, punks? You meet us next week in Dallas, Texas. You meet us on SmackDown, and you give us your answers. If you submit! I'll do anything for my family, but I need this one thing. Acknowledge me. Roman Reigns, I acknowledge you. As my tribal chief.
Enough to send the WWE Universe into a frenzy. You had to do an emergency podcast.
I was in a frenzy.
I am just waiting for you to show up in these Versace shirts.
Yeah,
that
I got
the Rock is wearing.
Bad news for the bump. The expense bill is going to go through the roof because I need to start upping my game. The Rock is making everybody up their game. But who's he acknowledging? The Rock acknowledging Roman Reigns as the tribal chief, an unbelievable moment. But not to take away from the fact that we got a taste of what The Rock is like in the boardroom. This is why The Rock is a billion-dollar superstar, because he took Cody Rhodes' challenge. He goes, no, we're not going to do that. That's a hard no. But what if I told you?
And I think you're going to like this.
And I think you're going to like it. I think it's pretty cool. I could give you the main event that you want for WrestleMania. No bloodline interference. All you have to do is beat the greatest duo that has ever been formed in the WWE. That's all.
And he let the WWE Universe fantasize about the thought of Solo Sikoa singing the national anthem.
Which I think got a rise out of all of us. We're all thinking how great that could be. We don't know what type of singing voice that guy has, but I've heard he's got pipes.
And you know what else we don't know? We didn't know heading into Monday Night Raw. We didn't know how Seth freaking Rollins and Cody Rhodes would feel about what The Rock issued on Friday Night SmackDown. But we knew that they would have thoughts of their own, and they kicked off Monday Night Raw.
What I want to know, Cody, I've asked you many times, and I've told you for weeks, man, I've got your back in this fight. So what I want to know from you, do you have mine?
To answer your question, I guess I also have a message for The Rock. Rock, it's been a long time since you haven't just been handed something. I think it's been since you had that $7 in your pocket, and I think you forgot. The People's Champion is not in perpetuity. Rock, I am not the same man as you. I'm not gonna whine in a 21-minute promo. I am coming to SmackDown with Seth frickin' Rollins. I am going to stand across from you, Roman Reigns, the wise man, the whole bloodline. In the great state of Texas. And this Friday, I will give you face-to-face, eye-to-eye, not whispering in your ear, my very clear and obvious answer for what's happening at WrestleMania.
So for the first time since the WrestleMania press event in Las Vegas, we will get to see Seth freaking Rollins, Cody Rhodes, Roman Reigns, The Rock, and the rest of the bloodline come face to face. The last time we saw it, you had to do an emergency podcast. Yeah. It was epic, and I'm expecting it to be epic once again.
I think it's going to be even more epic. Think about all the ugly words that have been exchanged since the last time. Now they've got to live up to what they've been saying. Everything that The Rock said on SmackDown, everything that Seth Rollins and Cody Rhodes said on Raw now, now they've got to confront that. Cody said that the answer was obvious, but I still need to hear the words come out of Cody Rhodes' mouth and come out of Seth Rollins' mouth. I need a graphic to be made. I need the announcement. Let's see if Cody Rhodes is really willing to put it all on the line.
I've noticed a shift in Cody Rhodes.
Oh, he's a mean guy. So
that may be taken a step farther. This Friday, we will have to wait and see. But, you know, Seth freaking Rollins has been in the middle of this Cody Rhodes bloodline story. But he also should probably be focusing on Drew McIntyre, his opponent at WrestleMania, because Drew McIntyre has been on an absolute roll. He had this matchup in the main event of Monday Night Raw against Jey Uso. This has been building since Clash at the Castle a year and a half ago, Sam.
And that looming threat of Solo Sikoa coming out of the audience, we've seen it so many times before. And who's more familiar with it than Cody Rhodes? And never again, he's saying. What did he say? He said he was a bloodline hunter, and he's living up to that.
He is, and we talk about that different side we see. And
but there's the numbers. That's the bloodline numbers. How smart is that? Solo comes from one side, Jimmy comes from the other, and Cody can't possibly take care of both of them.
And Drew McIntyre just taking advantage of the situation that he was put in. And this is what Drew has been doing so well, embracing this. He's not mad at it anymore. There goes his WrestleMania opponent, not even acknowledging the Scottish Warrior.
And those eyes say it all, almost insulting the Scottish Warrior on his path to destroy the bloodline, and he eats a claymore for his effort. Look, I talked to you about this on Raw Talk. Seth Rollins has to be aware of exactly what's happening in front of him. Drew McIntyre beat Jey Uso. Why? Bloodline interference and distractions. Drew McIntyre beat Cody Rhodes. Why? Bloodline distractions. So now, when Seth Rollins is distracted by the bloodline, what do you think Drew McIntyre is going to do?
I think he is going to take advantage of it.
Become the world heavyweight champion. That's what Drew McIntyre is going to do.
Drew McIntyre has been cracking me up. His social media after Monday Night Raw in the parking lot with the WWE Universe blasting CM Punk's music. I mean, this
guy. He might just like the song.
It's a great song.
It's a great song.
Truly a great song. Ryan, what is social media saying about everything that's going on?
So much. Megan really did love that video. She texted me yesterday that we have to talk about it on the show. I said, Megan, you got it. We're going to make it happen. Drew McIntyre's been crushing it, and so has Rey Mysterio, who returned to SmackDown this past Friday and did a little okey-doke, to quote R-Truth. Legado del Fantasma thought that he was on crutches, thought that he was still hurt from everything Santos did. Ultimately, Rey Mysterio took the attack to Legado, and Santos was none too pleased about it, saying, big mistake on social. However, the LWO was pumped with Zelina saying, we're back. Now, ultimately, a great week for Rey Mysterio overall. because on Monday this happened. I don't know if this made it a great week for Sam, though, because Dominic Mysterio, the quote-unquote greatest challenge to Gunther's Intercontinental title reign, didn't go great, Sam.
Well, yeah, but he was a great challenger.
Yeah, sure.
He put Gunther to the test. There was a handprint across Gunther's chest. Let's not pretend he didn't impress us all. Gunther was the better man on that night, but that night was just that night. That's all.
Gunther did say good effort. I'm sure Rey Mysterio had a hearty laugh.
Gunther was having a blast.
He would have. A deadbeat dad like that would have.
How
a hearty
dare you?
Laugh.
That's a WWE Hall of Famer. Let's pivot back to SmackDown. Let's talk about a moment that no one enjoyed except for maybe Damage Control. Dakota Kai did what a lot of people thought Dakota Kai was going to do. She turned on Bayley, and it really had social media in their feels. Bayley Mania here saying Bayley running out and attacking Dakota instantly. I feel sick, unwell, and very sad. Art right here says Dakota was the last person Bayley had, and she betrayed her. Ultimately, though, you know who was pumped about it? Like I said, Dakota, who simply said cry on social media. We're going to stay in the women's division, kick it over to the Raw side of things. We're going to even stick with the theme of tears because cry about it. This is what Liv said to Becky after interfering in her match with Nia, and this is not the same underdog Liv from 2022. She wants Becky to keep in mind. Liv Riot here says Becky's about to learn it's a new Liv. Absolutely, all the history that they have. And then Liv is still focused on Rhea like Becky is still focused on Rhea. Liv posted the full rivalry video that she has with Rhea. And Rhea, who's loving all of this, by the way, said, just a nice little reminder, this was a reply to Liv, that Liv for brutality is dead. We will see Liv and, I know, really a bummer. We will see Liv and Becky go at it this Monday. That's become an intense rivalry. Becky and Rhea is an intense rivalry. Liv and Rhea, an intense rivalry. Speaking of rivalries, let's look ahead to WWE Superstar Sunday because WWE Superstar Sunday is back and it's where unrivaled storytelling reigns supreme. This week we have a new episode of WWE Rivals, as I said, that tackles one of the greatest rivalries of all time, Undertaker versus Shawn Michaels. That will then be immediately followed by WWE Legends, and this week's legend is Scott Hall. That's this Sunday starting at 8 on A&E. Let's take a first look at this weekend's upcoming episodes right now.
The Undertaker and Shawn Michaels came through big when the spotlight burned its brightest.
WWE Rivals.
Arguably the greatest wrestling match of all time.
And then, WWE Legends.
He just oozes coolness.
I mean, he had it all.
This feels so good. Of course, a lot of people didn't know. I had these dark secrets I felt like I was hiding.
WWE Superstar Sunday. New episodes Sunday at 8. Only on A&E. Watch next day on the A&E app.
Can't wait for WWE Superstar Sunday on A&E this weekend. And as we've been doing every single week, we threw up a poll on the Bump social accounts asking, who were you? Were you Team Undertaker or Team HBK during their iconic rivalry? We have those results right now. We will take a look at the result of that poll right here. Always going to be a close call, but Undertaker 62% to Shawn Michaels, Team HBK's 37. Sam and Megan, whether it was Hell in a Cell, WrestleMania 25, WrestleMania 26, one of the all-time great rivalries. Can't wait to see it as we kind of document it through this Sunday on WWE Superstar Sunday, followed by WWE Legends with Scott Hall.
Thank you so much, Ryan. It is now time to welcome on our first guest into the studio. She came all the way here to Stamford, and since her arrival in WWE, she has taken the WWE universe by storm. It is officially Tiffy time. So ladies and gentlemen, please welcome on Tiffany Stratton.
Tiffy time.
There she is.
She is here.
There she is. Incredible.
Thank you. Thank you.
Trying to be professional.
Yes.
Oh, yes. Very professional here. Tiffany, welcome on Into the Bump. First time in the studio.
Yes.
How are you doing today?
Good. I think the show just got like 10 times better.
Okay.
I thought we were doing pretty good.
But I mean, better is always better.
Yeah, yeah. We always strive.
I mean, you have Tiffy time now.
That's great.
Yeah.
We do always strive to be our best. And you put out a video on social media the other day just talking about how excited you are to be here in studio. Let's take a look at that.
That's awkward.
Perth and an unforgettable.
Excuse me? But this show is so ugh. And what are these hosts? They look like a bunch of clowns. It's missing something. The center of the universe, me. Oh, can't wait to grace these peasants with my beautiful presence on What's the show called again?
The Bump?
Oh yeah, The Bump. Can't wait to show this peanut gallery what a real star looks like. It will definitely be Tiffy time. Toodles.
So I know it's early, but how are we doing so far?
Honestly, you guys should be thanking me for gracing you guys with my presence.
Thanks. Thank you for that.
Thanks. Drew's the savior of WrestleMania. Tiffany may be the savior of The Bump.
I hope so. We'll find out.
We will. All right, Tiffany, I want to kick it back to Friday because you're coming off of this massive match at Elimination Chamber, and you have to face a veteran in the division in Naomi. She's accomplished so much, and you were able to come away with the victory. What did it mean to you to go up against someone who's had accomplished so much history in WWE?
Honestly, it felt so amazing. It felt so reassuring. Someone as amazing as Naomi to even just be in the ring with her, I feel like it's such an honor. But unfortunately, I got the dub and I beat a former champion. So I feel amazing.
Yeah, I would too. I mean, there does seem to be some contention, whether it was leading into the Elimination Chamber, within the match, coming out. Of course, this week on SmackDown, it doesn't seem like Naomi is overly thrilled to have you as part of the SmackDown roster. Where do you think that divisiveness is coming from?
When I first arrived to SmackDown, I did slap a couple girls. And, you know, I had to make my mark on SmackDown. I had to show these girls that I mean business. Mm-hmm. And SmackDown now runs on Tiffy time. So that's exactly what I did.
Yeah, yeah. And I think that's a good thing. We actually have the footage. This is amazing to me. Your first night on SmackDown, your first night in a new position. You try to make the best impression possible. And you slap Meechan in the face. I think we have that.
Let's see it. Yeah, I'm sorry. I'm the center of the universe, and I've also signed a SmackDown contract. Where's my applause?
Girl. I'm sorry.
It's great for you.
You know what? I'm not afraid to step up to the baddest woman in WWE. And you're gonna remember me.
Oh!
Whoa, ladies, stop.
Hey.
I mean, so a solid arm on you, but also very quick running. You've got a lot of speed, which both I think can come in handy. What was that decision all about? Why Meechan, and why did you think like, oh, this is what I'll do to endear myself with the women's division? I'll slap somebody in the face.
Well, like I said, Bianca is one of the baddest women in WWE, and I had to show her that I mean business. And I showed her with a little slap. And now she knows that SmackDown runs on Tiffy time.
It's hard to debate it.
Not making many friends early on
time. I mean, I don't need any friends to win matches.
You've proven that. You have proven that so far. But is there any sort of, in your heart, do you worry maybe at some point not having friends will cost me?
No, not really. I'm a one-man band. So, yeah, it's just me and I'm the center of the universe.
I forgot about the center.
It's all about me.
Now, Tiffany, as we bring it to social, first of all, also for me, thank you for being here today. Thank you for making all of us better. Might not need friends, but you certainly have a lot of fans, as you already did, coming out of Elimination Chamber Perth. You were the talk of the entire weekend. As you posted here, Australia loves me. But from the press event before the event through the women's Elimination Chamber match itself, and definitely on social media, everyone was talking about you. Everyone was talking about Tiffy time, the center of the universe. What stands out to you now with a little bit of separation from that weekend, just how memorable it was?
Yeah, I mean, going into it, I was the rookie and I felt like nobody was really going to know who I was. So the fact that they were even, you know, chanting my name before I even came out in the press conference was so just reassuring for me. And I definitely left Perth with a newfound confidence.
No doubt about it. Now, the WWE Universe in Perth was absolutely appreciating you throughout the entire weekend. But after the match, obviously, it didn't go the way that you wanted to. You did have this to say in a digital exclusive. Let's take a look at that right now.
Obviously, Australia has great taste, I have to say.
But maybe if they would have cheered a little bit louder, I actually would have won.
You're blaming Australia?
Yeah.
Okay, well, what's next for Tiffany Stratton?
I'm gonna fly my pretty little self home back to the United States, in first class, of course, and I'm gonna show up next Friday and show everybody why I am the center of the WWE universe. Toodles.
Toodles.
So, Tiffany, coming out of that, I mean, simple question, have you forgiven Australia for costing you the Women's Elimination Chamber yet?
Gosh.
After quite a bit of thought, I do forgive you guys. It's totally okay. You guys were there for me. It was my first big PLE, so I honestly just want to thank you guys for being there for me.
So nice.
Wow.
So nice.
That's very, very generous. That's it. Yeah, that's why she's the center of the universe. Now, Tiffany, one more. We can't talk about social moments from Elimination Chamber Perth without talking about your incredible dive off of the chamber pod. This was the talk of social throughout the entire weekend, one of the most incredible moments of the year so far. For you, do you savor a moment like that because it gives you a chance to show everyone in the vision just how much you're actually capable of?
Yeah, actually that moment is still living rent-free in my head to this day. I will never forget that.
And everybody's still talking about it. Your athleticism has always been on display, whether it be backstage, running away, and, you know, hitting me chin in the face, or doing moonsaults off the Elimination Chamber. But a lot of this comes from your career as a gymnast. So how has that helped you transition into WWE?
Yeah, so I was a gymnast for 10 to 12 years, and gymnastics truly taught me everything that I know, not just about working out, just about discipline and life in general. And I've really taken, you know, the coordination, the grit, the discipline, and I have used it in wrestling. And I truly believe gymnastics is the reason why I'm so good and so quickly.
Confidence and athleticism. We've seen you stand up to some of the biggest and baddest women in WWE. Becky Lynch, Jade Cargill, Bianca Belair, Naomi. These are all former champions with the exception of Jade. But how do you feel you rank among the women's division in WWE?
You know, before when I was in NXT, I was a little nervous being called up to Raw and SmackDown just because it's a new roster, it's in front of a bigger audience, but I honestly, truly feel like I fit right in with all the girls.
You don't strike me as someone who gets nervous very often.
Yeah, I mean, we all have our moments, but for the most part, I'm pretty confident going in.
It seems that way. And I also feel like, you know, I've had you on the podcast before, and every time we talk, or anytime anybody talks to you, the conversation goes to how quickly you've risen up. I mean, when you think about it, a year ago today, you hadn't even won the NXT Championship yet. And now look at you. You're on the main roster. You're in the chamber. You're in the Royal Rumble. In the last year, what about you do you think has improved the most that's helped you get to where you're at?
Yeah, so with, you know, being so new to wrestling, my confidence for sure was one thing that kind of wasn't as good as it is now. I really didn't know what I was doing in the very beginning, and now I have, you know, had so many matches on TV, in front of live crowds, in front of 50,000 people, so I feel like now I'm truly confident and I know who I am in the ring.
Your confidence sets you apart. Like, you have a higher than average degree of confidence. And most people, that process that you just described takes years and years and years before it finally clicks in and they go, I got it. For you, we're talking about months. Was there a moment that it clicked in and you went, oh, I'm a natural?
I would say I kind of felt like I was a natural when I first started, to be honest, because
it's not shocking.
We did the rolls, we ran the ropes, and I was, like, naturally very good at it. The only thing was, you know, like, figuring out who I was and, you know, like, how do I act in the ring and who is Tiffany Stratton? And so I think that was the biggest life-changing moment in wrestling, is figuring out that stuff.
Just realizing how easy.
Exactly.
It was all coming. And bringing it back to confidence, it goes back to that first night on SmackDown. Right after SmackDown, for SmackDown Lowdown, you did an interview with our colleague Kayla Braxton that I want to reflect on that if we can.
We all know
was only a matter of time before Tiffy Time went to Raw or SmackDown. And SmackDown happened to be that lucky brand. And not only did I prove to everybody back at home and to everyone in the locker room that I belong here, and whether they like it or not, they're going to be seeing a lot more of the center of the universe. Toodles.
So the reason that I wanted to look at that again was because a lot of superstars say those words. But when you look in your eyes, you're not blinking. There's no part of you that feels like you're being performative. You believe what you're saying. You said that you were a little nervous getting to SmackDown. That was the first night. When does that go away? Did you just know as soon as you got there, oh, wait, there is nothing to fear?
I think when you're in Gorilla, it is so nerve-wracking before you go out. And then I always have this rule with myself. After I leave the curtain, we're confident, we believe in ourselves, and we're not nervous anymore. So I think after I had my debut match and I took the dub,
yeah, you did.
I felt the confidence just exhilarating through my body, and that's why I delivered that promo like that.
She has very high expectations for herself, Sam.
Well, when they're met, you're entitled to those high expectations, exactly. I suppose.
Exactly.
And do you think you've met those expectations so far? Has there ever come a time when you've questioned that confidence?
No, for the most part, right. I always am very confident.
Undefeated in singles competition.
Yeah, I mean, I wouldn't question. I wouldn't be questioning.
It's Tiffany, Tiffany, as we bring it back to social and speaking of high expectations, the WWE Universe now, with every passing event, has higher and higher expectations for your gear, which you seemingly always meet, which brings us to Megan Thee Stallion, who your gear was kind of inspired by at WWE Chamber. How cool is it for you to see people reacting so positively to your gear, and how do we make the Tiffy Time Megan Thee Stallion collab happen?
So I usually look on Pinterest for all my gear inspos, and I happen to come across this photo of Megan Thee Stallion in these cool cutoff pants and decided to make it a part of my gear. And the fact that everyone like loves it, I always feel like when you get a new outfit, you're always kind of afraid of people hating it or hating the colors. So the fact that all the fans always love my gear is amazing.
Now, speaking of collabs, hopefully we get you and Megan together one day. You collabed on a few TikToks on the way to Perth and in Perth with Nia Jax, which the WWE Universe was all about. Is there a level of mutual respect and friendship there between you and Nia?
Oh, yeah. Speaking of friends, I do think I have one friend, and that's Nia Jax. I think we're allies.
So
a bad ally.
Yeah.
A great ally to have. Now, one person who I can confidently say, we've talked about her a few times already, that maybe isn't on your side right now is Bianca Belair. You've interacted with her a few different times now. She took to social just yesterday and said, quote, her words, not mine here, of course, because I took her slap personal. Bet she keep her funky hands to herself now. Clocked her. Do you have a response to this? It kind of came out of nowhere yesterday.
Yeah, she loves that clip so much. I see her posted on Twitter, on Instagram, on TikTok. Like, get over it. You slapped me once. Now move on.
Oh, my gosh.
Fair enough. Now, we got a ton of fan questions for you. We're going to hit a couple of them right now. We're going to start with this one. I think it's a good refresh after what we just had to talk about. Tornado here wants to know, is it hard being the center of the universe and always being on the tiffy top?
What type of question is that?
Really good question.
What type of question?
Really good question, I thought.
Never. It's never hard. It comes naturally to me. I was born at the tiffy top. I was born at the center of the universe.
Fair enough. And then to tie it all around, do you have any favorite Megan Thee Stallion songs that you like to listen to?
Oh, I hate when people put me on the spot on this stuff.
Okay.
Is it Freaky Girl? Oh, no, that might be Nicki Minaj. I don't know. Freaky Girl? I don't know. I'm sorry.
Freaky Girl works. And it feels like that can be more inspo for you.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right, well, something we definitely want to talk about is starting March 1st. It is Women's History Month. We are wearing the shirts. You guys can make sure you head on over to the QR code right here and get your shirts, because throughout the month, we are going to be celebrating the long-standing legacy of women in the WWE Universe by celebrating our superstars and the diverse background and experiences they have, proving that any female can can aspire to be a women's champion. So make sure you check out the Women's History Month shirt with all proceeds benefiting Ad Council. So obviously a very special month for us gals, and you now have a platform and you're in front of all these. But I want to go back to when you were younger. Were there any women in WWE or just women in general that influenced you?
Yeah, so I grew up a gymnast, so I always looked up to, you know, Olympians, past world champions. And one girl I really looked up to was Shawn Johnson. She was an Olympic gold medalist. I thought she was amazing. She was powerful, she was confident, and she was kind of everything that I wanted to be when I grew up.
And now that you are grown up and you have this unbelievable platform, has it dawned on you yet that you could be influencing generations to come? There could be little Tiffany's out there looking at you the way you looked at Shawn Johnson.
Yeah, I mean, obviously, like, look at me. Why would you not want to be me?
I was just thinking that.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, it's just...
It's just crossed my brain.
Yeah, no, it's good. That's good. I'm glad that the confidence hasn't left yet is the thing. And, you know, we'd love for you to stick around for the rest of the show, because you have elevated the bump. I think that's undeniable.
Savior of the bump. Yep,
but before we move on to anything else, you found yourself on the main roster, on SmackDown, right in the middle of the road to WrestleMania. So whether it's Naomi or Bianca Belair, who you mentioned before, is there anything that you'd like to say to any of the women out there on the Blue brand on the road to WrestleMania?
I would just like to let all of you women know that SmackDown is running on Tiffy time, and I am the center of the SmackDown universe.
Wow.
Strong.
Big.
Statement.
Big.
Yes.
Period. Big.
Well, I tell you what, you guys, it's been so exciting to scroll on social media this week because I'm seeing all of these unbelievable pictures from WWE 2K24.
Yes.
The game, the deluxe edition is out today. Make sure that you guys get your hands on that. This game is filled with so many exciting things. And let's talk about some of these awesome parts that are coming in My Rise.
Yeah,
unleash
dude.
Your raw talent and become the undisputed champion. My Rise, featuring two thrilling career arcs and original storylines chronicling your ascent to WWE stardom from the men's and women's divisions.
And look, it looks pretty familiar, doesn't it? The bump is part of My Rise for the very first time this year in WWE 2K. I love My Rise. It's always been one of my favorite modes of the 2K games, but this year especially, not just because our studio is in it, but because you get to go through these elaborate career
long
stories.
That table is heavy. Look at Raquel.
I don't think people realize how impressive it is. This table, it doubles as a cooler. Not many people can do that video game or not.
Well, we saw Raquel just lift up, you know, an interview subject. I hope Tiffany doesn't, get any ideas from watching.
No. The physicality is just for 2K.
Yeah, I'm off the clock right now.
Good.
Okay.
Good.
All right.
Excellent.
Well, Caleb Braxton and Byron Saxton did an incredible job in the WWE 2K24 game. Let's take a look.
Welcome to The Bump and what is shaping up to be the most chaotic SummerSlam week in WWE history. I'm Byron Saxton.
And I'm Caleb Braxton. Less than a week before defending the undisputed WWE Universal Championship against Cody Rhodes in a brand versus brand main event at SummerSlam, Roman Reigns shocked the world and surrendered his title.
So My Rise is enough, right? It's so cool, so amazing to see that. Your favorite personality is in there. Your favorite set is in there. But beyond My Rise, so many new match types in WWE 2K24. I've already been in the Not Sam basement putting hours into this game. The ambulance match is in 2K for the first time. You can do finishers on top. Speaking of going on top, how about this? In the backstage brawl, not only can you have multiple participants in the matches, but that's a functioning elevator. Tiffy, you can ride the elevator in the backstage brawl. They got casket matches in this. You got guest referee. Back in a WWE video game, Tiffany Stratton, not only can you be a competitor in a match, but if I choose, I can play as you as a referee in my game.
I don't know if it's going to go your way if you have Tiffany as the referee.
I don't know. That's part of the magic of WWE 2K24. And of course, you've got the showcase mode, one of my favorite modes.
Oh, it is the absolute best because WrestleMania is the biggest event in sports entertainment where superstars become WWE legends. Experience a gripping retelling of WrestleMania's greatest moments in 2K Showcase of the Immortals, where you can relive a collection of some of the most unforgettable career-defining matches. Sam, you've been in the lab. Which ones have you been trying out already?
This showcase mode literally takes you from WrestleMania 1 all the way up to WrestleMania 39. You can try to stop Cody Rhodes from finishing the story.
So much excitement, so much going on. You are in a video game, which is just wild. But it is now time to welcome on our next guest to WWE's The Bump, a man who is determined to find his way to WrestleMania, and he's preparing for a gauntlet match this Monday. The one and only Sami Zayn.
Hey, Megan, Sam, Tiffany, hello.
Hello.
Sami, thank you so much for making the time. It's been a busy couple weeks for you on Monday Night Raw. How are you doing?
A little up and down, but more good than bad, thankfully, I would say.
Yeah, you mentioned that up and down. It's been a turbulent couple of weeks. And after what went down on Monday Night Raw, you did a digital exclusive interview with Kathy Kelly. Let's take a look at that right now.
Man, just WWE's it's a ride. You know what I mean? It's like, it's feast or famine. And I've certainly feasted in my day and I've starved in my day. Well, right now I'm eating again. I'm eating, and next week at this gauntlet match, I am going to eat, I am going to devour anything that comes in my way. I am going to devour the opportunity, because that's what's hard to come by around here, opportunities. And just when you think you've like secured your spot or your legacy or, you know, whatever, the curveballs just never stop, and I don't take it for nothing. And I said this earlier, but I've had a lot of important matches in my career. Well, they're all behind me. Right now, the most important match of my career is next week. The next match is the most important match of my career, because history's waiting for me on the other side.
Very fired up, Sami Zayn, and rightfully so. You are just days away from being in the ring with six dangerous men with an opportunity to face Gunther for the Intercontinental title at WrestleMania. So how are you mentally preparing for this gauntlet match?
Look, I feel a lot better going into this match than I maybe would have felt a couple of weeks ago. You know, part of what I was talking about there with Kathy, and you know, Tiffany, you'll probably experience this soon enough, but it's like the ebbs and flows in WWE. It moves so fast, and momentum one week is just gone sometimes the next. And then you think it's gone and you panic or something, and then it's back, you know, one big win or a couple of big wins in a row, and all of a sudden you're riding high. So it's just like, it's really hard to make sense of it. I feel better having a couple of really big, important wins going into this match now, for sure. And I think those are wins I needed at this time, because there were a couple of really important losses that came right before that. I could sit here and say none of it affects you, but I think any athlete in any sport will tell you that a couple of it's hard to not get your confidence shaken after a couple of important losses. And especially, you know, as WWE superstars, and this is something, look, I work very hard. You know, I'm at home right now. It's one thing when I'm at a show or whatever, I'm totally in WWE superstar mindset and all that. But when I'm home, I try to have a little perspective, which I think is crucial. And, you know, I don't let these matches try to make or break me, but we have a tendency to put so much on our shoulders as WWE superstars to where these wins or these losses or where we're at on the card invariably ends up kind of defining us. And it's a dangerous thing to do, but I think we all kind of do it on some level. And so, you know, it starts those couple of important losses when they come at a bad time. It does a lot more than just shake your confidence. It starts really getting you to question yourself. And I'd be lying if I didn't say I didn't question myself, but something that I've had to use, that I've had to rely on my entire career, is just this like borderline, I don't even want to say delusion, but this sense of belief that has to trump that. Because if you give in to these self-doubts, you know, you'll find yourself out the door pretty quick. You have to have this like intrinsic belief in yourself that trumps that. And I think that's what's carried me through pretty much my entire career, but really what's carried me into this match. And I said it in that interview with Kathy Kelly, and I mean it. You know, main event of WrestleMania, great. Passed Intercontinental title wins, great. All these really big, important matches in my career, great, but they are all behind me. So right now, the most important match of my career is this next match. That's how I see it.
Yeah, and I think, you know, speaking on that self-doubt that kicks in and it starts to kick in, I think especially this season, WrestleMania season, and I think this might be something valuable, you know, when you're looking at somebody like Tiffany Stratton, who's had a lot of success very early on. When you look at not just the last couple months, but the last 2 years, right? And you go back to WrestleMania 38, and you had one of the breakout performances of that WrestleMania. And then you go to WrestleMania 39, and you're in the main event winning with your best friend, to then be leading up to this year's WrestleMania without a match. Does that make it worse? Does hitting that high make this part more difficult than it would be?
Yeah, for sure. For sure. That's a great point. But I think, again, the thing that kind of centers me or anchors me and doesn't let me, you know, go too far down that rabbit hole, that mental rabbit hole, is the fact that it's not just the last 2 years. You're talking about 2 years. Well, it's been 22 years that I've been doing this. So there have been some ups and downs in those 22 years. So, you know, even when I was riding at my highest, you could say in the main event of WrestleMania, because it has to be the biggest match I've ever done for sure, and having all that momentum going into it, you know, I didn't buy into the hype. You know what I'm saying? Like, yeah. I feel relatively the same now that I did then. You know what I'm saying? It's like just having this, you have to kind of be grounded. Like, you could let these losses shake you, fine, but only to a certain extent. And you could let these big wins and big WrestleMania matches or whatever it is, all the momentum in the world, all the fans talking about you, you could let it feel good, fine, to a certain extent. But you have to stay centered. You have to stay centered. And I think that's the lesson that just time has given me. So 100%, again, I'd be lying if I said like, no, no big deal. You know, whatever. I'm just being honest here. And maybe I shouldn't. Maybe I'm sharing too much. For better or for worse, this is just, you know, you're asking me questions, I'll give you honest answers. But I think the fact that coming off the highest of highs last year gets you questioning yourself when you don't quite have that spot carved in for yourself the following year. I think that's natural. You know, we tend to compare ourselves to others. I it's something I work on, to not compare myself necessarily to others, but you can't help but compare yourself to yourself or where you were a month ago, 2 months ago, a year ago, whatever. But at the end of the day, look, I said I would, I don't want to sound like I'm morbidly depressed here or anything like that, because ultimately I am feeling good, because all these things that I said would happen have kind of happened. And that's where that belief, that self-belief has kind of come into play. Because I said I'd be a champion. I said I'd do something historic. And I said that even though it looks bad now, a path to WrestleMania will present itself to me. And now all three of those things are right within my grasp. You know what I mean? The path is there. It's this gauntlet match. That's it. If I get through this gauntlet match, that's it. I punch my ticket to doing the things that I talked about, to becoming a champion at WrestleMania and doing something historic. Because make no mistake about it here, Gunther is doing something historic, and beating him would be historic. And last year, I ended the longest reign of all time, the longest tag team championship reign of all time. And now this year, I have a chance to potentially end the longest intercontinental title reign of all time. That's historic. And that's what I'm en route to doing right now.
And I think you should
be. That's really where my head's in the game at. You know, I'm trying to balance all that, because there is a little bit of that, you know, the self-doubt, whatever the hell I'm talking about here. But there's also this, like, it's beyond belief. It's beyond just self-belief. It's like a faith. Faith coupled with like a burning passion to not squander the moment, and the moment's upon us.
And if you look at the way momentum is going for you right now, you should be feeling good, I think. You go back to Monday night, and within the same breath, you find out that not only do you have this opportunity for the gauntlet match, but now you've got a challenge against one of the most devastating opponents that Raw has to offer. It would have been a disaster, I think, for you to lose this match, and you didn't. You won. The momentum continues. How much do you think that victory fuels you going into this Monday?
I think it's huge because it's not just about a single win. You know, again, I'm trying not to be overly dramatic about this stuff, but wins and losses, look, they don't define you, but sometimes when the stakes are high, it says a lot about you, you know? And I think that's really, you know, I don't want to be tooting my own horn here, but I think really what's gotten me this far is that this is when I do my best, when the chips are kind of down and your back is up against the wall and it's like, all right, man, you've talked. You've talked about being a contender. Well, now your back's up against the wall. Are you who you say you are? Right?
Yeah.
And so when it comes down to it, and yeah, you got like a monster. I haven't been able to catch my breath in 2 days because that guy's huge and he landed right, like, you know, on this bottom part of my sternum. I haven't even been able to catch my breath, but I still walked out with the W, big win. And I think that speaks volumes to the kind of dedication, the grit, you know, that's a character statement to me. So that's what I'm proud of. And you're right. You know, when you talk about that momentum, it's not just about a couple of wins. It's about, all right, you know, I say I'm a player, I say I'm a contender, and I'm backing it up. That's what's important to me. And that's what's really got me riding high going into this Monday. And like, look, you could see there's a little bit of both. I'm all over the place here because, you know, I've got my doubts, but I've also got this, this belief, but, man, I don't know. I'm going to let it all play, you know? You put all of it in there, and I'm not trying to block one out or lean into the other. It's just, it's a whirlwind of emotion. And sometimes it's hard to put into words because there's so many emotions going on at the same time. But instead of trying to explain it, you know, we're doing an interview here. So my job is to try to explain it to you.
Yeah.
I'm having a hard time because it's just a ball of crazy emotion. And all I can do is harness that emotion, the good ones, the bad ones, the doubt, the passion, the belief, whatever it is. Stop trying to put it into words, harness it all into energy. And on Monday in that gauntlet match, just let it play out. And that's always what's carried me. And I'm confident and I believe and I have full faith that that is what's going to take me and punch my ticket to WrestleMania.
And at the risk of complicating things even further, that energy shifted immediately on Monday Night Raw because a reality check came crashing down on you when Big Bronson Reed got in there to remind you there's no time to celebrate. This is what you're going to be looking at next week. Coming off of that, was there anything to that reality check? And is there anything that you want to say to Bronson Reed or to anybody else that you may be staring down this Monday night in that gauntlet match?
Well, look, full credit to him. I've never even been in the ring with him. I've never interacted with him in any way, so I certainly didn't see him coming. I said earlier that I haven't been able to catch my breath in 2 days. Part of it was from Ivar, and the other part was from that splash, that tsunami. So he did damage. I'm not going to hide that. Whether I'm going into this match at 100%, I'm really not sure because I thought I'd feel a little bit better now than I do. So physically, I'm still not totally at 100%. But again, I've had some of the best matches in my career and the biggest wins in my career not at 100%. So I'm not going to let that play. It's more not just the physical damage, but obviously he's trying to play a mental game, you know, fair play to him. Sure. But he's got my attention. And if we cross paths in that ring, I will just, you know, I'll take care of it then. I'm not going to overthink it because I don't know the order of the gauntlet match. I don't know where I'll be. I don't know anything. So again, it's kind of this fine line of like trying not to get in your own head about when I get that guy in the ring. I might not even get in the ring with him. I don't know. But if I do, I'm prepared. And he'll get his receipt.
Now, Sammy, as we bring it to social, you talk about the whirlwind of emotion heading into this gauntlet match. There's also been, as you also mentioned, a whirlwind of momentum. In the midst of all of that whirlwind, there was this moment with Gunther, where ultimately now the WWE Universe is really excited about the prospect of you winning this gauntlet match, as we see here, and you facing Gunther at WrestleMania. But a few moments after that moment with that picture, he laughed in your face. How disrespected do you feel by Gunther heading into this gauntlet match and on this road to WrestleMania overall?
No, I loved it, actually, because, you know, that's what happened a few seconds after that picture. And a few seconds before that picture was me saying that I knew a path to WrestleMania would present itself to me. And I didn't know what it was. I'd just come off a big win. I was feeling good. I said, I think it's going to happen. I think the path to WrestleMania is going to show itself to me. And then, in, you know, and he walks. And he laughs. He laughs in my face, which is, okay, cool. You're cool. You're a cool guy. That's fine. But it doesn't matter because in that moment, I was like, there it is. My path just walked right by me and it presented itself. That laugh was the universe telling me, here's the moment. Here's your guy. There's your path. That's your WrestleMania ticket right there.
Clear as crystal in that moment. Now, Sammy, whether it was with Kathy on Monday, with us right now, as I see the YouTube chat reacting so positively at everything you're saying, or in your initial interview with Jackie Redmond that sparked everything you're talking about now, there was so much positivity. Lo here saying, your time will come, Sammy. We're behind you all the way. Eleanor saying, you're the best future world champion, without a doubt. So many positive reactions, Sammy. Mike saying, you deserve this title, whichever one it may be. How amazing is it for you to know that you're displaying all of this real-time emotion, sometimes don't even necessarily know where your head is at, as you just said to us right now, but knowing that the WWE Universe is hearing it and responding to it in such an abundantly positive way?
Man, I know it's going to sound corny, but it's everything. It really is, because, you know, look, I'm not... There's a lot of different kinds of WWE superstars. There really are, you know, and some people are super cool and some people are super strong and some people are just super good looking or whatever it is. There's a million reasons why fans would love you. And I don't really know what mine is other than just being myself. For better or for worse, my entire career, it's the only thing I've really been able to do is to just kind of be myself. And I don't really have the perfect words to put that into what that actually means. You know, what characteristics what that means to people, what it means to me, I don't really know. I was trying to talk about all these different emotions and articulating them. And sometimes it's not about the words, man. It's just about the feelings. And it's the feelings that you put out there and WWE Universe feels them back. And they give that back to you. So, you know, that's kind of been everything to me. It means really more than I could ever put into words, to be honest with you. So I'm not even going to try, but it means everything.
Sammy, before we let you go, do you have any final thoughts on this gauntlet match that you are about to endure on Monday Night Raw?
Nope. I'm done thinking. It's, You know, you could think yourself into a lot of funny corners of your mind. So I'm not thinking. As I said earlier, I'm feeling a whole lot. And on Monday, there's no more time to think about it. As far as I'm concerned, this is it. This is the path to WrestleMania. This is the path to becoming a champion, doing something monumental, historic, that'll be talked about for years and years and years to come. This is it. I'm going to be present, I'm going to feel it, and I'm going to go for it, and that's it.
Sammy, thank you so much for the time. Best of luck on Monday Night Raw, and we'll be
thank
watching.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, you bet we will be.
Thank you. Appreciate that.
Sammy was awesome. Tiffany, lots you could learn from something like that. I mean, I know you don't ever lack any confidence, so hard for you to relate to the ups and downs.
Are you worried about that all? Are you worried that the ebbs and flows that happen, or do you feel like it's only rising?
I mean, he said something that I actually really resonated with. He said that he sometimes just has to have a delusional amount of confidence, and I truly believe like that's what has gotten me here this fast, this early in my career, is I've always had just a delusional amount of confidence going into my matches, and I should not be having this confidence with only 2 years of experience underneath my belt, so I really resonated with that.
Well, when you are the center of the universe, I think you're born with that confidence.
Delusional.
Yeah, I think that's how it
you
works.
You said it, you know.
Yeah, Delulu is the Salulu.
Delulu is the Salulu. Hashtag it and put it on a shirt. Put for the whole Tiffy army.
All right, let's talk about who's coming on the show next week. We got the Wolf Dog. Woo, 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 woo.
I don't know.
They will be in studio, bark. And I'm doing that next week when they're here.
We're trying to prove that we're professionals, and you're woo, 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 and
you have a siren.
Wait,
okay?
That's for emergencies.
I don't know where you draw that. I can't bark, but you can pull out a siren.
What's better, the siren or the barking?
The siren.
Yes!
Sorry, the barking is cringe.
Yes, cringe. Ooh, cringe.
All right,
thank
you guys,
you.
Thank you so much for watching this week's episode of The Bump. For Sam Roberts, I'm Megan Morant. For Ryan Popola and Tiffany Stratton, we will see you guys next time. Toodles.